Hello viewers, I am Dr. Robiul. I work as a lecturer in pathology in a medical college hospital, and I am making this video for my students and also for you. Hope someone finds this helpful. Today's topic is Turner Syndrome Part 2. This video will contain brief discussion about the clinical features, diagnosis, and management of Turner Syndrome. Okay, a lot of topics, so let's begin. So first, we will talk about the clinical features of Turner syndrome. And as you can see in the whiteboard, I have already drawn an image that is showing the major clinical features of Turner syndrome. Now, always remember, severely affected individuals of Turner syndrome generally show edema of dorsum of hand and foot, and they will also show swelling of nape of the neck. Now, why is there swelling or edema of dorsum of hand and foot? The mechanism is due to lymph stasis. And why is there swelling of nape of the neck? The mechanism is due to markedly distended lymphatic channels. And as a matter of fact, this swelling of the nape of the neck that is happening due to markedly distended lymphatic channels, this swelling is also referred as cystic hygroma. Now, as these individuals develop, the swelling gradually subsides. However, it leaves bilateral neck webbing and persistent looseness of the skin of the nape of the neck. So you can see in this image, I have also drawn webbing of neck. And another interesting clinical feature is the low posterior hairline. Now, in 25 to 50% cases of Turner syndrome, we may also see congenital heart diseases. And the left side of the heart is most commonly involved, and particularly common among congenital heart diseases in case of Turner syndrome are preductal coarctation of aorta and bicuspid aortic valve. Now, always remember, individuals with Turner syndrome during their puberty will fail to develop secondary sex characteristics. That's why individuals with Turner syndrome will have little pubic hair, their breast development will be inadequate, and their genitalia will remain infantile. Now, short stature is a very important clinical feature in Turner syndrome, and we have already discussed in the previous video of this series why there will be short stature in an individual with Turner syndrome. As a matter of fact, an individual with Turner syndrome rarely exceeds 150 centimeters in height. Now, another important clinical feature is amenorrhea, and as a matter of fact, Turner syndrome is the single most common cause of primary amenorrhea. And we had talked about amenorrhea in the previous video, and there we had seen that in individuals with Turner syndrome, ovary becomes atrophied and there is no ovum or no follicle in their ovary, and the ovary is also called streak ovary. And as a matter of fact, amenorrhea and short stature are very important clinical features for establishing a diagnosis of Turner syndrome. In another word, if an individual came to the physician with short stature and amenorrhea, then the physician may suspect that the female may be a case of Turner syndrome. Now, moving on with the clinical features, in 50% cases, individuals with Turner syndrome develop autoantibodies that will react with their thyroid glands. And in half of those cases, hypothyroidism may also develop. Now, another interesting clinical feature of Turner syndrome is this cubitus valgus. Now, what is this cubitus valgus? Always remember that cubitus valgus is a medical deformity, and here the angle that is seen between the fully extended forearm and the body is greater than normal. Let me explain. Now, normally, in a normal individual, there is a slight angle between fully extended forearm and the body. However, in individuals with Turner syndrome, that angle will be greater than normal. Okay, so here we can see that the angle is greater than normal between the body and fully extended forearm, and this is known as cubitus valgus. Individuals with Turner syndrome may also develop glucose intolerance, obesity, and insulin resistance. However, their exact mechanism is still unclear. So these were the major clinical features of Turner syndrome. I just missed one, and that was pigmentation. So you can see that in individuals of Turner syndrome, there may be also pigmentation. So these are the major clinical features of Turner syndrome, and now we will move on and talk about the diagnosis of Turner syndrome. Now, Turner syndrome is usually diagnosed during childhood or at puberty. Sometimes it can be diagnosed before birth too. For example, during pregnancy, if a routine ultrasound scan shows abnormalities in the fetal heart or kidney, or if it shows lymphedema, Turner syndrome may be suspected. Similarly, if such abnormalities are presented at the time of birth, Turner syndrome may be suspected. If a female child shows the typical features of Turner syndrome, for example, short stature, webbed neck, widely spaced nipples, Turner syndrome may be suspected. Now, whenever Turner syndrome is suspected, we must confirm the diagnosis, and karyotyping test is done to confirm the diagnosis. Now, in karyotyping test, we analyze the chromosomes in our cells, and the test can be done before birth or after birth. For example, before birth, sample of amniotic fluid can be collected from the amniotic sac that surrounds the fetus by a process called amniocentesis, and then fetal tissue in that sample of amniotic fluid is analyzed to know the karyotype of the fetus. Similarly, after birth, we can collect blood from the suspected case of Turner syndrome, and then we can analyze that sample blood to know the karyotype of the individual. So this is how we can diagnose Turner syndrome, and now we will move on and talk about the treatment of Turner syndrome. Now, unfortunately, there is no cure for Turner syndrome. However, many of the symptoms associated with Turner syndrome may be treated. An individual with Turner syndrome may be under the care of a pediatric endocrinologist during her childhood and adolescence. Growth hormone injections are beneficial in some of the cases. Now, such therapy with growth hormone is usually started early in the childhood, and it may increase the final adult height by a few inches. Estrogen replacement therapy should be started at the time of puberty, that is around 12 years of age, and it will initiate breast development. Estrogen will also prevent osteoporosis. A little later, estrogen along with progesterone may be given to initiate monthly periods. Now recall that in 25 to 50% cases of Turner syndrome, we see development of cardiovascular abnormalities. Such cases should be referred to the cardiologist and they will often require surgical correction. Now always remember, individuals with Turner syndrome have higher risk of developing infection in their middle ear. Repeated infection of the middle ear may also lead to hearing loss. That's why an ENT specialist should also be involved in proper management of a case of Turner syndrome. Now, individuals with Turner syndrome often have elevated blood pressure. That's why their blood pressure should be monitored routinely, and whenever hypertension is detected, that should be also managed properly with proper medication. Now, individuals with Turner syndrome in 50% cases develop autoantibodies that react with thyroid gland, and half of those cases will also develop clinically detectable hypothyroidism. That's why thyroid function tests should be included in the routine follow-up of an individual with Turner syndrome, and whenever hypothyroidism is detected, it should be managed properly. Now, glucose level in the blood and urine of an individual with Turner syndrome should be monitored properly to screen out diabetes, because recall that individuals with Turner syndrome are also at increased risk for developing diabetes. Now, individuals with Turner syndrome may develop osteoporosis, particularly during late adulthood. That's why bone mineral density should be routinely monitored with the help of DEXA scan. Now, if individuals with Turner syndrome develop psychological problems, psychotherapy should be recommended, for example, counseling or cognitive behavioral therapies should be given. Now, always remember, almost all individuals with Turner syndrome are infertile. However, pregnancy may be possible with donor embryos. Now, in conclusion, we can say that although there is no cure for Turner syndrome, however, with proper medical support and treatment, an individual with Turner syndrome may lead a healthy and happy life. So, this concludes our video on Turner syndrome. I hope this video was helpful. If you like my videos, do comment, share, subscribe, and let me know. And for my students, I will also recommend you to go through your textbooks to know more information. Okay, so that's all for today. Until next time, take care and stay blessed. Thank you.